Welcome.
Wonderful to have you here. Thank you for coming to another event here with the gallery. My name is Theodore. I'm the gallery curator, and today I am very pleased to present Serhat Tanyolacar, who's going to give a little presentation, a little of his background about his work. So let's welcome Serhat.
This evening, beautiful Oregon evening. Before I start talking about my works, myself, I would like to invite all of us to have 1 minute of moment of silence to honor the victims of wars in the Middle East and Ukraine. Where should I start? I was thinking about this, how to start. We have to start all night. My name is Serhat Tanyolacar. I'm a Turkish-born interdisciplinary artist, printmaker, political activist, and autism advocate. For over 25 years, I've been making art for the purpose of opening dialogues and gathering awareness on social justice issues, and so as a socially responsible human being. I will start this presentation by showing my background, which is Turkey, Turkey. Actually, we just changed our name. I'm not sure any of you know this big change. We don't call the country as Turkey anymore. It became Turkey. So it's officially, legally changed to Turkey. And it's beneficial, it's helpful to see my background, and because my background is direct influence of what I do, what I make as an artist. So I was born in Ankara, March 2nd, 1977, as a Turkish citizen. And this is Ankara in the 1950s, some changes. So there is, I believe, the population of 7 million people in Ankara. This is Kızılay Square, and I had a performance right there. I didn't know I can see where I was. 2014. This is me. Of course, we have to keep a picture. This is me, I think I was 4 months old. Innocent. And this is me holding a Turkish flag. And Turkish flag is very significant in Turkey. It is sacred. It's untouchable because it signifies your loyalty to not only the nation but military, even further, religion. So in Turkey, all boys are born as soldiers, and furthermore, many people, great majority of Turkish people, are born as Sunni Muslims. So this is something, they used to actually just write the Muslim as soon as the baby was born. They changed that now. They are a little more liberal. We are a little more liberal, but that was the situation in 1970s, 1980s. Another components which binds the nation. I would say nationalism, militarism, religion, and of course patriarchy. So I will never hesitate to say that my nation is patriarchal. So these are my mother, my mom, my dad, and my brothers. And I see myself as a lucky individual because we were never forced to believe, to follow anything dogmatic, anything in terms of fundamentals, in terms of any belief system. So 99% of Turkish population are Muslim, mainly Sunnis. In Turkey, even if you are not devoted Muslim, especially since our elected president starting 2002, he has been president. Keep that in mind. We have a president who has been a president for over 20 years. And this is an electoral democratic system. And we've been, but the issues I will mention shortly are, we have the only democratic system as an Islamic country in the world. But what is that democracy and how it functions? I will show and talk about the functionality of our democratic system. So let's talk about some parallels. This is 1950s. We had, since 1923, the foundation of Turkey, we had four military interventions, and allegedly, of course, these are allegedly sponsored, supported, organized by the United States government, the CIA as well. And this is Adnan Menderes. He was the prime minister of Turkey until May 1960, and his administration, 1950s, received generous amounts of support from Truman. Any of you know Truman or Truman doctrines? So, and he was jailed and he was hanged by the military junta. This is, keep in mind, this is the prime minister, this is the head of a democratic country. And along with him, Fatih Rüştü Zorlu, Hasan Polatkan, they were also hanged. And the 70s, and still going. These are Deniz Gezmiş and Yusuf Aslan. They were youth leaders. They were student leaders, and they were also hanged in 1972, executed by another coup, another junta, military junta. Deniz Gezmiş on the left, he was a huge inspiration for me in terms of activism, in terms of how you can be political, how you can be a student. Very important name. And 1972, actually, three student leaders were hanged, and they were called, we now call them Üç Fidan. This is May Day massacre in 1970s, again 1977, the year I was born. And this was in Istanbul. Yeah, this is Taksim Square, Istanbul. And Turkish military opened fire and killed the civilians. And in America, you have similar experiences. I can't, you know, we have similar experiences. But one of the biggest differences I can mention, the change, we didn't improve in terms of human rights. So we still violate human rights by all means. And this was May 1st. Basically, people were celebrating May 1st, which used to be here celebrated too, as the Labor Day. And we don't celebrate it here. We stopped celebrating 1889. But May 1st here used to be Labor Day as well. So this is, again, the Taksim Square, parents holding their child running away. And 2004, I did a print. So same people, the person person on the left is Erdogan, President Erdogan. When he went inside Van Gogh's room, a serene environment, it's absurd, obscure. This is one of the things, one of the strategies, elements you can see in my work, absurdity. Because when you think about what is the basis of politics, an application of politics into daily life, it doesn't even make sense. So the politics do not support us, do not govern us. Politics, the reason we have politics is because of the state. It protects the state. And these are 1980s now. Keep in mind, 1950s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and 2000 we had another coup. And this is 1980s, I can't talk about my lived experiences, vivid experiences. This Canada regular military general and conducted the coup in 1983. These are Turkish soldiers. And I remember these moments. You know, soldiers, tanks in the streets of Ankara and everywhere. This is Ankara University, a very important place politically, socially, in terms of activism. And my experiences in terms of seeing the young people in Turkey growing up, my home was right across from Ankara University, and I used to see students chasing each other, riot police chasing the students, and there were moments that we had to dodge bullets, we had to cover. And one side of my childhood was covered with bullets. So this is 1980s social and political climate. And I remember those, and those moments stay in any human being. And now, this is 2014, compared to the events starting in the 1960s, 70s, and we still had the riot police. This is Taksim, Istanbul. Right after 2013 was the Gezi Park protests. This is the following 2 years. And there were moments, I was there in Istanbul, in Ankara. There were moments that the riot police used so much gas. The canisters was, imagine this entire space. You can't even walk because it was covered with canisters. That many, it's like a firework, the way they, and they were targeted as citizens, and they killed citizens, which I will show that to you. And this is a very pivotal moment for me, Urmumcu. I decided to change my direction as a Turkish citizen, and I had to leave the country. He was assassinated in 1993, but mid to late 90s, there were 27 journalists who were assassinated. And some of them linked to Islamic organizations, fundamentalist organizations, some of them linked to CIA, allegedly, of course, allegedly. And I, in a way, I made my plan in 1990s to leave the country, to depart my home. In a way, I had to. And speaking of numbers, until 2007, from 1990s to 2007, there were 39 journalists murdered. So the 90s were very brutal. And this is Serhat Tanyolacar, amazing human being. I personally know him. He was assassinated by a right-wing Turkish nationalist. He was an Armenian-Turkish journalist opposing the government policies against the minorities in Turkey, not only the Armenians, but the Kurds as well. So, to honor the people, the innocent people who were murdered, in 2021, I made this print. Some of the people you see, this is Çetin Erç, this is Serhat Dink, Urmumcu, Bayu, Çok, and Golum, we had Golum here too, of course, because our president, Recep Tayyip Erdogan, he sued a cartoonist, because the cartoonist depicted him as Golum. And the cartoonist was fine, actually. I think he was jailed as well. So this is a current work on the use of Kadar. So any of you know what Kadar is, or Kismet, Kadar, destiny. And in Turkey, I would say we live with our destiny. We live, and that's, again, looking at a coffee fortune, but we follow that nuance, you know, everything is based on our destiny, fate. So all these images underneath the ornate frames, they are printed with coffee. I made a coffee ink and I wrote printed with coffee. And starting in 1923, the founding year of Turkey, the Turkish Republic, I have 100 images showing significant events of each year, 1923 to 2022. So I'm going to speed up some because I don't want to. And this is again 100 images. Some of the early. In 1990s, I went to Bilkent University for my BFA, and I started investigating ways to engage the public space, utilizing the public space, engaging the audience, or provoking the audience. So this was a tree I stole from a public park, which was a dead tree, and I stole it with a couple of friends. We went to the public park, and it was already decayed, it was falling, but we just put it in a truck and to my studio, and I covered it with mirrors. But these were some of the early works from Bilkent years, 1998 to 2002. And I realized soon after I installed these works, installations, they were all vandalized within minutes. Like, and imagine the brutality of this. This is about, I would say, at least 400 pounds, three. And it was rolled down maybe 500 yards. So there is a, at first, you know, you become angry. Why do people violate? Why do people vandalize? But soon after you realize that this is a strategy and there's a provocation. There's a reaction. Then you can engage. You can direct that negativity to something positive. So these are box-like. This is screen printed, full storm, serigraphy screen print. These are still Bilkent years. And I left my country in 2002 and I moved to Memphis, Tennessee. And soon after that, I started having my second BFA at Austin Peay State University, Clarksville, Tennessee. And these are some of the works from that time. Installations, some of the drawings, this is a drawing, trying to remember the title, a long time. Impossible Equation, because again, the critique of militarism and war. And this is how much actually United States spent. I did this in 2003 when during the war in Iraq, and America spent over $4 trillion in Iraq just for the war. And we are talking about how much we suffer in terms of education, women's rights, everything. And America already spent $14 million. So, and when you divide that to the 2003, the casualties, and this is just military casualties, so 4,446, which equals that number. But when we talk about, when we think about humanity, that doesn't even make sense. That doesn't, I'm not kidding you, but this is actually, there is an equation military uses. When a soldier dies, they use an equation. Like those things actually do not even make sense in terms of humanity, human beings. And this is graduate school times. I went to University of South Florida. I started utilizing public space as an interventionist. This was a public performance in New York City. I did this right around the turmoil or the issue sparked by Park 51, which is Cordoba House. Park 51 was an Islamic cultural center which was proposed to build in New York City, three blocks from Ground Zero. And during that time, 2010-11, public outrage. Oh, that's Islamic center, terror, you know, there is disrespect. And this was my reaction. So there is always a responsibility I see and I take as an artist. But beyond that, I take responsibility as a human being to address the issues in terms of injustice, in terms of bias, prejudice, and so on. And I had two jubbas. These are the garments I had. Jubbas, Islamic garments. And one had articles from the New York Times, all depicting the bias and the issues that the Islamic Muslim Americans live, have to live in daily lives. And that was the first jubba, and underneath I had another jubba, let's see, here this is the American flag, and they intertwine, they overlap, collapse in each other. In a way, it's the game that, you know, how can they even be together? Maybe they can. And during the performance, I was going back here, I was reciting, singing, the national anthem, and I finalized the performance, right? This is the finalized place, 9/11 Museum, and I gave an Islamic prayer, Al-Fatiha, and to honor the victims of 9/11. And then I was asked to participate in an exhibition. This is what I did relating to 9/11. This is an homage to the homage to August School Dance Kiss, and the story of Kiss, a love story that, you know, the lovers never could be together. So they couldn't even kiss. If you look at the sculpture, the lips actually do not kiss. August Rodin's Kiss. And performance, this is Farewell. I had this performance in 2015, last work and the last time I was able to enter. And I was a neo-Ottoman. I played with the cultural cliches or cultural identity which has been didacted, imposed by Turkish government. So there is this whole embellishment, there is this whole forceful appreciation of Ottoman identity, which ended in 1970s, 80s, 1800. But still, that identity is just a way to unite the people under flag, under religion, under Ottoman Empire, which is, again, that doesn't make sense. So I was being a sultan in Istanbul, in Ankara. Basically lived my life as a sultan, as an Ottoman man, or neo-Ottoman man. And the reactions, you know, is public. And once the, anywhere, this is not even just the performance, but once the work, anywhere, is in public space, it becomes a part of public domain. So you don't have much authority. I mean, you can create an authority, but then it will take away the poetics. So I don't force, hey, I'm an artist, you know, but the dialogues were, if there is a success, the work and the success happen when there are interactions and when there are dialogues. And I had all kind of dialogues in terms of negative, positive, which, again, there is no such thing negative, positive. Everything happens through the conversations and the dialogues. It's not just the performance. So this is Kapalıçarşı, Grand Bazaar, this is Ankara. And it's beautiful if you think you just sit down to people as a normal person, a normal human being, and then reactions just happen, you know. And the one important part of the documentation, so we have to document everything. So this is Ankara, and I was in the museum of Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, founder of modern Turkey. And again, you learn how to negotiate too. At first, when I entered the museum, they said, you can't do it. And through the dialogues, you know, hey, I'm, you know, doing this as a response to the, you know, the explainer word. But there is always, because at the end, we're all human beings. You find a way. So And then I was inside the Monselvin as the Ottoman Turk. But when I went to, of course things changed. The last, it's a site-specific intervention, and when I went to the palace, because we had a palace of the president of Erdogan, I was stopped, interrogated, and some of the footage from the documentation was erased. So that's March 1715 was the last time I was able to make art.